Somehow I got into Russia. The Church of Pergamos has, we're going to look into today, God says, I have a few things against you. Yikes. We need to settle that before we see him. If Jesus comes tomorrow to spend some time with you, would you answer all his questions or lie to hide the truth? Would you welcome him with open arms or even let him in? If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then? If Jesus calls your number, could you leave today? Are you ready to lay down your earthly goods and walk away? Would it take a month of Sundays to tell him of your sins? If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then? If the sky turns black as midnight in the middle today, and somehow you knew Jesus would soon be on his way, would you have to beg forgiveness or reach out and take his hand? If Jesus comes, if the sky turns black as midnight in the middle of the day, and somehow you knew Jesus would soon be on his way, would you have to beg out and take his hand? If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then? If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then?
Amen. The children can be dismissed for Children's Church. If you're joining us for the first time, we're currently in a series, or you could call it a book. It's the book of Revelation, and we find ourselves looking at the letters to the seven churches in chapter 2 this morning, with the third letter to the church in Pergamos, a message we entitled Double Trouble. These letters are written to seven specific churches in seven specific locations, but they are also written to all the churches of all times, and they have application for us as a church, but also application for us as individuals. And today we're going to look at the church in Pergamos, and we're going to pick up, I'm going to begin reading in verse 12 to 14, and then I invite you to keep your Bible open as we're going to go through a little bit more as we go through the message. So let's stand to honor the Word of God, and let's read these first few verses, looking at double trouble in Pergamos. Verse 12, chapter 2, the book of Revelation. John writes, through the Holy Spirit, and to the angel, that is the pastor of the church in Pergamos, write these things. It says, he who has the sharp, two-edged sword, I know your works, and where you dwell, where Satan's throne is, and you hold fast to my name, and did not deny my faith, even the days in which Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was killed among you, where Satan dwells. But I have a few things against you. Let's pray. Holy Spirit, we ask now that you would take the sword, the double-edged sword of the Word of God, and Lord, that you would cut away all the facades. Lord, that you would cut away all the flesh, that you would cut away the chains and the bars which hold us back. And we pray now, Lord, that you would give us eyes to see Jesus, ears to hear his Spirit, and hearts, Lord, to walk in the light as he is in the light. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. It was December 7th, 1941, that 353 Japanese airplanes swarmed into Pearl Harbor, and within a few hours, the United States lost 8 battleships, 6 airfields, almost all their planes, and 2,400 soldiers were dead. This attack began at 7:50 a.m. in the morning, supposedly as a surprise attack. But many people do not know that 50 minutes before that attack, 2 U.S. soldiers detected some red dots on the radar. They came in to a young lieutenant who was on duty. He was the only one because it was a Sunday morning, and he was notified. And he said these critical words: don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. And many churches today, and many Christians today, and many lives today are being devoured, families are being destroyed, strength is being depleted, because we have adopted this philosophy in the Church of Jesus Christ. Don't worry about it. It's not a big deal. It's just how people are. It's not a big deal. Don't worry about it. Well, Jesus has a few words to those people who say, don't worry about it in the Church of Jesus Christ. As we come into the third letter, Jesus deals with one specific issue in this letter. It is this issue right here. It's very simple, but it's yet complicated. Spiritual compromise. Mark it down. Spiritual compromise. It's when we as a church or we as an individual say, just don't worry about it. So let's define our terms. What is spiritual compromise? Spiritual compromise is not choosing other gods to worship. Okay? It's not choosing other gods to worship. Instead, it's trying to include other gods in our worship. Does that make sense to you? I worship Jesus, but I'm going to also worship A, B, C, D, E, F, G, as well as Jesus. So it's combining multiple worship. It's pluralism at its best. And a great Old Testament example, if you want to read about him in the book of Kings, is King Jeroboam the First. He blended this whole religious system. Oh, you can worship Yahweh, but you can also worship the golden calf. Blended worship. And Jesus Christ comes this morning with the double-edged sword, and he says, I got a triple-double for you. For those of you who like those terminologies, three things. He comes with a double-edged sword. He says, I got double trouble in Pergamos. And third, he says, I got a double reward for the overcomers. So we got double-edged sword, we got double trouble, and we got a double reward. Let's look first. Let's dive into it this morning. I sat with Lisa at breakfast, and I said, well, the message this morning is not really palatable to the taste buds this morning, but it is good at the end. So we're going to get through it. God has a word for us, I believe, here at the First Baptist Church of Howard this morning. So let's look at the double-edged sword, verse 12. Jesus, as in every single one of these letters, introduces himself with a picture from Revelation chapter 1. And he says these words, he who has the sharp, two-edged sword. We all need to just take a step back for a second. This is a different picture of Jesus. Jesus is coming with a sharp, two-edged sword coming out of his mouth. And notice it is a sharp sword. That's a little alarming to me. If Jesus comes to you with a sharp, double-edged sword, that means we got some problems in the church. And this sword, I think, is what the Romans would be familiar with. It was what we call a gladius sword. It is about a 24-inch blade. It's not a real big blade. It has two sides to it. If you actually look at this thing, it sort of looks like a tongue. You know, it's got the two edges. It's sort of on the smaller side. And he says, this gladius sword is coming from my mouth. And everybody would have understood what this symbol was meant to mean. This sword was everywhere in Rome. It was on coins. It was on houses. It was on statues. It was everywhere. It was a symbol of Roman identity. And what it really, truly symbolized was this. Absolute authority. Rome was the one with the sword. And if you have the sword, you have the right to life and death. If I handle the sword, so to speak, that means I have the right to kill you, and I have the right to give you life. And this is what the symbol is. And here to Pergamos, Pergamos was like, if we could equivalent it today, it was the Washington, D.C. of the day. It was the political capital, so to speak, of Asia Minor. People were dying for their faith under the sword of Rome. Jesus says, excuse me, Pergamos. I have a double-edged sword coming from my mouth. And let's go a little bit deeper into this illustration. The sword in your New Testament is talked about 404 times. And the sword is representative of the Word of God. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 says that the Word of God is living and it's active. It is sharper than a two-edged sword. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 17 says, take up the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Jesus, first of all, establishes this to the church. I am the one who holds absolute authority in the church. Rome does not hold absolute authority in the church. Okay? Now, we've gotten that confused a little bit lately in 2024. What we are trying to do here in 2024 is we're trying to take the world's ideas, Rome's ideas, and we're trying to implement them into the Church of Jesus Christ. And he says, no, that is not how it's supposed to operate. The job of the church is not to bring the world's ideas into the church. But instead, it's to bring the Word of God to bear on the hearts of His children, whether it agrees with what the world says or whether it does not agree with the world says. Jesus says, I'm the one with the sharp, two-edged sword. So if you're a note taker, you may want to mark this down. The first step to compromise, spiritual compromise, is this. You mark it down, you can guarantee it. When you abandon the Word of God, you will get to spiritual compromise. You take the Bible out of your school, you take the Bible out of your pulpits, you take the Bible out of your courthouses, and you will have spiritual compromise. Now, question, Why do people want to take the sword out? Why do people want to take the sword out? Why do people have a problem with this book? Because it's a sword. That's why. Think about it. If you're around a sword long enough, what's going to happen? You handle a sword long enough, you're getting cut. I saw a picture this week. You know, someone was with barbed wire and got cut. If you are around barbed wire a long time, you're going to get cut. If you're around the Word of God long enough, you will get cut. You ever come to a service like this and maybe you're like, ouch. Yeah, because it's the Word of God. It's sharp. If you're never getting cut, that means the preacher's not preaching the Word. Now, you shouldn't walk out of the church service every week like, oh my goodness, I'm wounded. No, but if you are around the Word of God, you should be getting cut at some point. And that's why many preachers have abandoned it. So this is how it goes. We're just going to keep the sword in the sheath. We're just going to keep the sword covered up. And we're going to replace the sword with philosophy. And let's just keep the message real neutral. Like, let's just love everybody. Everybody's on their way to heaven. Can't we all just get along? And Jesus says, no. I have the sharp, two-edged sword coming from my mouth. We cannot adopt this philosophy in the church. Don't worry about it. Double trouble. When we adopt this philosophy, look at verse 13 to 15. So Jesus comes wielding the sword. And first of all, he says, I got some good things about you. Pergamos was not all bad. There were some good things happening at Pergamos. Okay? He says here, I know where you dwell, where Satan's throne is. Again, these are staggering statements in the book of Revelation. I know where you live. It's where Satan's throne is. Imagine that. We think Las Vegas is bad. I have never been to Las Vegas. I know some people here that have been to Las Vegas, and you're like, they tell me, you wouldn't believe just walking down the street what you see. Now, we think that's bad. Well, you can times that by probably 10 times in Pergamos. If you could think it up, if you could dream it up, culturally, sexually, whatever you could dream of, Pergamos had it. And on top of the Acropolis of Pergamos, I want you to picture a city, and on there's a sort of a hill there in the center, and on top of that Acropolis was this great temple, and it was the temple of Zeus. The Greek god Zeus sat on the temple of Pergamos. And if you looked at it from a distance, this thing looked like a giant throne. And that's what many people think he's talking about here, where Satan's throne is. Interesting side note for you historians. I thought this was interesting. I decided to include it. This throne of Zeus was excavated in an archaeological dig, and you can actually go visit this throne in Berlin, Germany today. And here's what happened with this throne. The Nazi regime was coming up to power, and there was an archaeologist by the name of, or architect by the name of Albert Speer, and Hitler wanted this grandstand built so he could speak his venom. And Mr. Albert Speer took the throne of Satan and replicated it. And what you look at in the Zeppelin grandstand in Nuremberg, Germany, where Hitler held his rallies, it was in a template of what was in Pergamos that day, the throne of Satan. Is that demonic? That is demonic, my friends. And here, in the middle of all this disaster, is a little church called Pergamos. There is a lampstand in the middle of all this darkness. Imagine that, church. Sometimes we think we're supposed to go monastic. That means like we're supposed to just remove ourselves from everybody and remove ourselves from all the sin and all the pollution and all the junk. Yes, we are called to be a separate people, but listen, where did Jesus live? He lived among the sinners. He lived among the dirt. He lived among the people. We are never called to move out to the mountain somewhere and just hide out till Jesus comes back. Imagine if for a moment, if I say, hey, Travis, we're going to do a church plant. Okay, we're going to do a church plant. Hey, where do you want to do this church plant? We're going to put it right next to the throne of Satan. Huh? Yeah, that's where we're going to put this thing. We're going to put it right there in the darkest place possible. And I think that's what Jesus wants. Jesus wants the lampstand to be in the midst of the darkness because all, again, not all was bad. Look at this church. They were a loyal church. Even in the days of Antipas, my faithful servant, Antipas, the history tells us, they threw this Antipas guy into a bronze bull and he was lit up on fire. This smoking hot bronze bull, we're just going to burn this guy up. Well, Antipas died, but they stayed loyal. They were loyal to his name. It says there, you did not deny my name, you did not deny my faith. They were loyal to his name, they were loyal to his faith. This is what that means. They never denied the deity of Jesus Christ. They said, Jesus is Lord. They never moved on that. They stood strong that Jesus is our rock, Jesus is our Redeemer, Jesus is our Savior. They were loyal to that. One problem. When it came to sin, they said, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. So now, Jesus takes the sharp double-edged sword and he plunges it really deep into this church of Pergamos and he says, I have a couple things against you. Double trouble in Pergamos. Two things, you can mark it down. It looks like this. Balaamism and Nicolaitanism. Give me that in American terms, worldliness and tolerance. Worldliness and tolerance, verse 14. Alan alluded to it. Here we go. But I have a few things against you. Because you have there those who hold to the doctrine of Balaam. Let's stop right there. What's the doctrine of Balaam? Balaam is an important individual. He is mentioned in the book of Jude, the book of 2 Peter, and the book of Revelation. His account is in Numbers chapter 22, verses 25. We're going to read through it. No, we're not. You can read through that for your homework when you get home this afternoon or this evening. It's pretty interesting reading. Numbers chapter 22 to 25. The summation of the doctrine of Balaam can be found in Numbers chapter 31, verse 16. Let me give you a cliff note on Balaam. Here's the cliff notes on Balaam. There's a king of Moab. His name is Balak. Now, Balak doesn't like Israel. He sees Israel as a threat. He hires Balaam as a false prophet to curse Israel. Balaam cannot curse Israel because God stops it. He tries to curse them, but he ends up blessing them. Okay, so he can't curse Israel. So, what happens? Balaam evidently concocted this idea. Well, how are we going to get these people to fall into a curse? This is what we're going to do. We're going to get them to compromise. We can't get them to maybe deny Jesus or deny Yahweh God, but we can get them to compromise. Well, how are we going to do that? Well, what do men like? Well, men like pagan women, and men like pagan food. Women and barbecue. That's what we're going to do. Balaam says, hey, you see Moabite women? They're pretty cute, okay? And they got that good food that they sacrifice to the idols. Why don't you get some of those cute Moabite girls to go down and intermingle with the Israelite guys, okay? And they're just going to compromise with them. And what's going to end up happening? God's going to have to judge that. And listen, 24,000 people die because don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. I read an account in India. This was off the quote, off the record. That, you know, they want to snuff out Christianity in India. And the one guy was quoted saying, don't persecute them. He said, don't persecute them. They'll become strong and spread. Instead, he said, do this. I want you to build cinemas, drinking halls, nightclubs, gambling dens, and they will destroy themselves. Pretty simple. Pergamos compromised their convictions for the sake of being politically correct, for the sake of popularity, for the sake of fitting in, for the sake of monetary gain. This church became tolerant of evil in their midst. Let's bring it into today, shall we? Let's try to draw this into today. We are here in 2024. We have entire sects of Christianity, entire denominations, entire populations who are not denying the name of Jesus Christ. They are staying loyal to his name. We believe in Jesus. We believe he's the way, he's the truth, and he's the life. But, hey, I can get down. Hey, I can get down with women in the pulpit. I can get down with that. Hey, I can get down with homosexuals in the pulpit. I can get down with that. Hey, I can get down with couples living together in sin, and that's not a problem. Hey, don't worry about that. Why are you getting so worked up about all that? That's not a big deal. Hey, it's 2024. Get with the program, Pastor. Get with the program, First Baptist. It's okay. I can get down with legalized drugs. Look, it's legal in how many states now? It's okay. Why you got to make it a big deal? Don't worry about it. I can get down with transgenderism. I'm not going to deny Jesus, but I can get down with it. And Jesus comes with a double-edged sword and says, no, you can't get down with that. You can't get down with that. He's like Pontius Pilate. Remember Pontius Pilate? He said, what I have written, I have written. What God has written, God has written. The Bible says in Psalm 119, verse 89, he says, the word of God is settled forever in heaven. Amen and amen and amen. That means culture might change. That means the world's going to change. People's opinions are going to change. Presidents are going to change. Hey, but guess what's not going to change? The word of God. It is not going to change. It's easy. Ready, guys? It's easy to take the searchlight and start shining it on churches and shining it on people. But let's for a moment take that searchlight and shine it on us. What are we allowing here at a First Baptist Church that God says, that's not going to cut it? Let's get more personal. What am I allowing in my own life that God says, you're saying don't worry about it, and I'm saying get rid of it. You're saying don't worry about it. I'm saying get rid of it because it's going to destroy you in the end. John Stott said about this church in Pergamos, he said, Jesus was grieved about the waywardness of the minority. There was not everybody was going off the chart. But the nonchalance of the majority. You had people in the church doing their thing, and the majority were like, huh, it's okay, don't worry about it. No one was going to confront that. No one was going to say a word. Hey, they're doing their thing. They're doing their thing. They're not affecting my life. They're not affecting my family. Let them go. Don't worry about it. Spiritual compromise. Back to some notes. It happens when you abandon the word of God. And how does it happen? It happens little by little by little by little. It's like this. It's just a little bit of food. Sacrifice to idols. Hey, it's only a couple brews. Hey, it's only a couple hits of that joint. Hey, she's only a friend. It's only a couple text messages here and there. It's not a big deal. Here's a verse for you. Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 15. The little foxes spoil the vine. The little foxes. It's not the big thing, not the big lions. It's the little foxes. Hey, the little foxes will divide your marriage. Hey, the little foxes will corrupt the church of Jesus Christ. The little foxes will corrode the home situation. Imagine if we, as a people, whatever your business is, whatever your industry is, especially if it's like one of those businesses, like you got to be on point. If you operated 1% off, just 1%, Imagine the airline industry, the aircraft engineers, if they operated with 1%. What's one? It doesn't matter. Could you imagine getting on an airplane, guys and ladies? The pilots are, hey, good morning, how's everything going? He's like, everything's going good, just the instruments are off 1%. It's okay, though. That 1% might matter when you're landing the plane, huh? 1% matters. They held to the doctrine of Balaam, which is the doctrine of compromise in the church. And they held, verse 15, to the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. The Nicolaitans are mentioned in chapter 2, verse 6. To Ephesus, he said this, the deeds of the Nicolaitans, I hate them. Chapter 2, verse 16, he says, the doctrine I hate. So Jesus hates two things about these characters. He hates their doctrine. He hates their deeds. So what's this all about? The theology of the Nicolaitans went like this. Paul confronted in Romans chapter 6, verse 1. Should we sin that grace shall abound? What they were teaching was this. God is so good. God is so gracious. God is so forgiving that he'll just forgive everything. He is a forgiving God. He is a loving God. He will forgive any sin. He will do it at any time because he's gracious. But listen carefully. The grace of God, the undeserved, unmerited, unearned love of God should not cause us to dive headfirst into a pool of sin. It should not do that. It should do the opposite. This is hyper grace. This is a misappropriation of the love of God. This is an important verse, guys. Titus chapter 2, verse 11. Titus 2, verse 11. It talks about the grace of God, and then it says this. It teaches us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust and to live soberly, righteously, purely. He's saying, listen, the grace of God does not free you to sin. You know the grace of God is working in your life when it's empowering you not to sin. That's what the grace of God does in your life. It doesn't say, well, go ahead and keep sinning. It says, no, stop it. It empowers me not to go that way. How does that do that? This is the best way I can describe it, guys. When you look at the cross, when you look at what Jesus did for you, when you look at the nails and you see the side and you see the crown and you see all the stuff that Jesus went through, why in the world would you want to do those things he died for? It should push you the opposite direction. I want to do things that please him now. I want to do things that just are his heart. The grace of God frees us from compromise. It doesn't make us comfortable in the compromise. He says, I got double trouble in Pergamum. You hold to the doctrine of Balaam, and you hold to the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. But then he says these words again. He gives a charge to these folks. And what's the charge? It's very simple. Repent. What do you got to do? Repent. That means turn around, go the opposite direction. That's what it means. It doesn't mean saying, I'm sorry. It means saying, I'm sorry, turn it around, and going full throttle the other direction. That's what repentance means. And he says, to those who repent, those who overcome, I got a double reward. Watch this, verse 17. To him who overcomes, here we go, I will give hidden manna and a white stone with a new name written on it. You have to ask the question this, guy. This is the question you have to ask. Who overcomes what? What are we overcoming? Who overcomes the temptation to compromise with the world? To that individual, to that church, Jesus makes two promises. He says, I'm going to give you hidden manna. Hidden manna? What was manna? It was that bread that fell from heaven. Remember back in the wilderness? It was that flaky stuff that just fell on the ground every single day. And where did they put that manna eventually? Do you remember? They put it in the Ark of the Covenant under the lid of the mercy seat as a reminder that God provided for them in the wilderness. And Jesus said in John chapter 6, he said, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. He said, I am the real manna. So what Jesus is telling these people who overcome the temptation not to compromise with the world, he says, I have a very private provision for you. You might live in where Satan dwells, but I'm going to provide for you, and I'm going to sustain you. And there's just going to be this intimacy that we're going to have. As you feed on me, I'm going to sustain your life, this hidden manna. And then he says, I'm going to give you a white stone with a new name. Now, what is that? I've been asking that question for a while. And you know what I concluded? People really don't know what that is. This is what I've concluded. It speaks to a permanent stone, intimate, private relationship with this individual. There's some like 12 interpretations of this, okay? And you say, well, Pastor, you're not off the chain that easy. Like, did you do your homework? Like, what do you think it is? This is my take, all right? This is just my take. Take it for what it's worth. He's talking about the wilderness. He's talking about Balaam. He's talking about manna. So I believe the illustration comes from the wilderness. I believe it has the idea of the high priest. The high priest wore an ephod. He had stones on the ephod with the 12 tribes of Israel, and those names were inscribed on those stones, and he held them on his heart, so to speak. And he says, to the one that overcomes, I'm going to hold him really close to my heart, and I'm going to feed him with the hidden manna and the sustenance that he needs. And I'm going to give him a new name that nobody knows. What's that all about? The only thing that I can think of is it's like, you know, sometimes husband and wife have these names that they call each other, pet names. Now, if somebody else called your hubby that name or your lady that name, super awkward, right? Right? Super awkward. Jesus says, there's going to be a name. It's just going to be between me and you. Between me and you. And it's going to be very intimate. It's going to be very special. It's going to be very personal. Jesus says, this is what I have for the overcomer. You're going to be all mine. The ones who want to play with the world and want the world to come into the church, he says, this is not for them. This is for the overcomer. And as the worship team comes up, I told you I watched the debate to a point, and then I clicked it off. But I think these words were written way before 2024 by a gentleman by the name of Dr. Lawrence M. Gould. He's the president of Carleton College. He was. And he said these words about society back then. I forget what year it was. He said, I do not believe the greatest threat to our future is from bombs or guided missiles. He says, I think we will die when we no longer care. There's a lot of people not caring today, ladies and gentlemen. We care about this and we care about that and we care about this. How much do we care about what's happening in our spiritual lives? Let us not be the ones that Jesus comes to with a double-edged sword. He said, why did you just simply say, don't worry about it? Let him who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying. And as we conclude, as we pray this out, guys, here's the challenge. I see a couple young people here. Listen, you're going to be in transitioning to life, into school, you don't make the decision then. You make the decision now. Don't think you're going to stand in the university. Don't think you're going to stand in a workforce that is full of pagan idolatry. You have to make this decision right now. Who will you serve? Will you live your life with this attitude of don't worry about it? Or no, I'm going to walk the walk. I'm going to talk the talk. I'm going to be about my Father's business. That decision is made now. Second thing, maybe there's blips on our radar to this morning. Maybe God's been revealing stuff to you, and there's red dots. You've been just saying, you know what, it's not a, let it go. I'm just going to let it go. It's not a big deal. Now's the time to deal with that stuff. Get the red dots off the radar. And maybe today someone's already just like, I'm knee-deep in it today. I'm just knee-deep in it. It's okay. Jesus says this, repent, turn around, just turn around, come back to me. The Father's arms are open wide. Where do you find yourself in this message? I pray that we find ourselves walking in the light as He is in the light. Heavenly Father, we thank You, Lord, for the sharp two-edged sword of Your Word. Lord, that it's good, that it's sharp. Father, I pray, Lord, now for decisions. Decisions, Lord, to follow You. Lord, I just pray just You would just search hearts this morning, Lord. All of us probably have things going on in our hearts that are just like little blips on the radar. You said, you know, that should not be there. Lord, let this be a day where we deal with it. Get it right before You. Before we walk out of these doors this afternoon, Lord, we just want to say, Lord, we're laying it down today. We're not going to live that way anymore. We're not going to think that way anymore. We're not going to operate our lives like that anymore. Let this be a day, Lord, where maybe someone who's already just compromised a ton, maybe emails are sent, text messages are being sent, relationships are already hooked. This is a day where we make a decision. Say, you know, I'm going to get right with the Lord. I'm going to turn the other direction. And I'm going to walk and run back to Jesus Christ. Let that be today. Father, we thank You that You are a God of mercy and that You are a God of grace. And Lord, that Your Word declares to us that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And Lord, as we sing this last song, as we worship this, Lord, worship out, Lord, this morning, we sang Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. Would You let the grace of God this morning flood our hearts, flood our minds, not drawing us to sin, but drawing us far, 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 far away from it, Lord. And may it be said of First Baptist Church of Howard that we overcame the temptation to compromise with the world. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Amen. Let's all stand.